Hey, for those I haven't had a chance to meet, my name is Josh, and I'm the pastor here at New Life, and I am just so blessed to get to see you here this morning. And if you are a guest this morning, we'd ask you to take the Connect card located in the seat back in front of you and fill that out, place that in the offering when it comes by in just a moment. In fact, if you're a regular, go ahead and show them how it's done. This is our way to get to know you and learn how to serve your family most effectively. And so if you can take that card, fill that out and place that in the offering. The backside of that card is ways for you to get plugged in the life of our church here in just a couple of weeks. A little fun preview for you. We're going to have some opportunities for you to get connected, because really, when we're talking church, the life of our church is not just Sunday morning, and we would even say not even primarily Sunday morning. It's all throughout the course of the week, and so we want to encourage you to get plugged in to place of service, to a group, and one of the ways that you can do that is through this card. And so give me a little preview, a little heads up. It's an exciting time to be a part of the New Life family. On September the 15th, just a few short weeks, we are going to be having the official launch of our Stowe campus. Come on, somebody, all that hard work and effort and prayer, all that is culminating into this, and we're just starting to see God do incredible things. I wish I could tell you all the fun things that are happening over there. Let me tell you just a couple, because they're really cool, okay? So one of the things that we were praying for, and for those of you that are guests with us, we started a journey about a little over a year ago with a church who was kind of needing some additional assistance, and they said, hey, would you be willing to take us on as a campus? And so we said, absolutely, we want to do this. And so we started that journey and began the process of rebooting that and breathing some fresh life into it. And one of the things that needed some fresh life was the facility in a lot of areas, some of which we could do, like we can paint, right? We can do that, and a lot of it's already been painted. One of the places where we didn't have the money was a lot of the facility needed carpet, and it was going to be about $40,000, and we just didn't have that. So we were like, well, maybe we can put a rug down over that stain that looks like somebody died there, right? So, like, maybe that's what we'll do, right? So, there's, rugs all over the facility. I don't know, right? So, we're just going to say, God, you got to provide, because we just don't have it. We don't have it. We're going to focus in on this, and maybe as this grows, we can do this. When you know it, God answers prayer, right? So somebody walks to the door and says, hey, I'd like to give you like $40,000 so that we could put new carpet down in the building. Right? Isn't that awesome? That's awesome, right? So this is cool stuff. This is what's happening in the life of the church. And we got a lot of things happening right now. So if you got, number one, you got friends in Stowe, September the 15th, get them there, right? Get them there, because it's going to be really awesome what God does there. Second thing is we need your help to, like, do a little bit more work. So on the 7th, we're going to be having a work day. All of our campuses, in fellowship, Stowe and Aurora, are going to put in some hours so we can get the house ready for guests, right? So if you can help us on that day, it'd be from 10 to, I think, 2 lunches provided, so we'll give you a free lunch for a little bit of elbow grease and manual labor. We appreciate you doing that. And then a couple weeks, and all this is in your bulletin, I'm kind of stealing some of Mike's thunder, but I want to really share this and drill this in your heart, is every fall we do a time of prayer and fasting. Normally it's late in September, but we felt like when we were planning all this, we probably should move that before the launch. Does that make sense? Because we need a lot of prayer and a lot of fasting to make this work. And so in your bulletin, I believe my head, now the dates are all fuzzy in my head because I'm doing this on the fly. So it is the 14th, 13th, 12th through the 14th. 12th through the 14th, we're going to have prayer and fasting. It's going to go back and forth between the Aurora and Stowe campuses. Take advantage of this time. Come over to Stowe on the nights when it's in Stowe. Pray that God would move mightily there, because we didn't do this because we needed something to do, right? We got plenty to do. We did this because God was calling us to do this so that we can reach people for Jesus Christ. We've already seen that take place. We've already seen life transformation happen. You can be a part of that. You can help facilitate that by being a part of both this workday and, more importantly, being a part of prayer and fasting as we prepare for this lunch. Now, listen, I know that everybody here wants to go to Stowe on the 15th, okay? You can't. They don't have enough space. We need your seat to be here, not there, so there can be somebody that lives in Stowe So just if you're tempted, if you get an invite, it's not for you, okay? We want to make sure as many people can come on that day as possible. So if you have your Bible, turn to Ephesians chapter 4. And if you don't have one, that's okay. Words will be behind me here in a moment on the screen as we work through the book of Ephesians. We've been in this book now for a couple of weeks, start of middle of the summer or so. We started in the book of Ephesians, which is a letter to a church that's located in this big metropolitan area of Ephesus, which is in modern-day Turkey. If you were to try to find Ephesus today, you'd have a little trouble because about half of it is underwater now because of a silting that took place a few hundred years ago. But Paul writes this letter from prison to these people that are gathered in the Ephesian church. It was the church that he served as a pastor in. He was there for the longest period of his ministry life. God did incredible things while he was there. And here's a letter that he writes that's totally positive, okay? At the end of the day, you know, if you read like Corinthians or you read Galatians, you're going to find that he's putting out a lot of fires, right? So he's pastored these churches and now they've gone wild and he's trying to like, you know, get them back on track. Well, Ephesians by and large is not that letter. Ephesians is a letter that's like, hey, listen, I'm at the end of my journey. Here's some things that matter. I'm at the end of my life, and at the end of my life, I'm evaluating the stuff that really matters, and this stuff right here that I'm sharing with you is what really matters. The beginning of this book, and this little recap is more than just me catching you up in the story. It's important background because sometimes we forget, and remember, he's building out an idea here that's going to serve us today. First week, we learned about a big cosmic God-sized plan, like a plan that was set in motion at the beginning of history for you and I who were far from God to be brought close to him. Like God had this big, crazy, cosmic, huge, lots of moving parts plan so that you and I could find hope in him. And the way that would happen is we who are living in darkness, in brokenness, in sinfulness, in lostness, right? We were facing wrath, we were facing judgment, and then what does God do? God sends his son, Jesus Christ, Ephesians chapter 2, to die for our sins. We talked about, you know, remember we talked about grace, mercy, and justice, right? Let's start with justice. Justice is getting what I deserve, right? Right? Mercy is me not getting what I deserve. And grace is getting something that I don't deserve. Right? So we talked about how God came and he satisfied justice for us, that he took what we deserved for us, gave us forgiveness instead, right? Something I didn't deserve. And he gave us grace through faith so that we could come to Jesus Christ. Like, he did all the heavy lifting. He did all the work to give you a new status and a new name. We talked about that quite a bit. Like, how he just transforms your life. And not only does he transform your life and give you a new status, now you're a child of God. You're adopted into his family, which means you get all of the benefits of being in the family. But now you've got these people. Not only is God helping you, you've got these people to your right and to your left that are on your team. And you get to work together to build each other up. We talked about that in Ephesians chapter 4. We build each other up so that we can together grow to maturity in Christ. So, with that as a backdrop, I'm going to read a rather sizable chunk of scripture that all talks about the same stuff, okay? And basically, okay, so Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 17. So I tell you this, and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as Gentiles do. That word Gentiles is just basically people who are not followers of God, right? People who are not followers of Christ. So you must no longer live as Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they're full of greed. Now, before you think that Paul is super judgmental, if you remember back to Ephesians chapter 3, remember when Paul says, hey, we were all outsiders at one point? So he's not saying like, hey, we're better than them. He's saying we were once them, right? We were once lost in our darkness and our brokenness, right? That, however, verse 20, is not the way of life you've learned. When you heard about Christ and you were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus, you were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off the old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, to put on a new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbor, for we're all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you're still angry. And do not give the devil a foothold. Anyone who has been stealing must no longer steal, but must work and do something useful with their own hands, that they may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their deeds or their needs, that it may be benefit to those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness and rage and anger and brawling and slander. Anybody been brawling lately? Along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other just as in Christ God forgave you. Follow God's example. This is verse 5 of chapter 5. Therefore, as dearly loved children, and walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. But among you, there must not be even a hint of sexual immorality or of any kind of impurity or of greed, because these are improper for God's holy people. Nor should there be obscenity, foolish talk, or coarse joking, which are out of place, but rather thanksgiving. For of this you can be sure, no immoral, impure, or greedy person, such a person as an idolater, has an inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of such things, God's wrath comes on those who are disobedient. Therefore, do not be partners with them. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of the light. For the fruit of life consists in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. And find out what pleases the Lord. Have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. It is shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret, but everything exposed by the light becomes visible, and everything that is illuminated becomes light. This is why it is said, wake up, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Be careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Do not get drunk with wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another with psalms and hymns and songs from the Spirit. Sing and make music from your heart to the Lord. Always give thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, I have read lists. There are lists like this one all throughout the scripture. Like, here's what you do and here's what you don't do, right? Those kinds of lists. In fact, we just spent a rather sizable portion of our church life looking at the Ten Commandments. Here are the things you don't do, here are the things you do, right? Now, I've grown up in church. I know church. And the kind of church that I grew up in was kind of the the kind of church at times that was really into the list. Anybody else grow up in one of those churches, right? This is what you don't do, this is what you do, and then you have lists upon the list. So they make lists based off of these lists. And so I can remember being at church on a Wednesday night, even into my early 20s, walking through what you know the sanctuary, so the auditorium where everybody gathered for service. And it was like an off hour, off night. Nobody was there. I was the only one there. And then one of the deacons saw me. He's like, "Why are you wearing shorts in the sanctuary?" Right? That's what I remember those times. Like the lists of a list of lists, like super self-righteous people. Some of the words that we use is that's legalistic, right? So it's legalism, and if you're not a church person, that's okay. You don't know that word, but that's a word that's like been created to define this whole category of living basically under rules. Like, don't do this, do this, right? And there were people who felt like they were deputized by the Holy Spirit to make sure that you followed the list perfectly. Am I preaching or am I preaching, right? Like this is real. There are people who feel this commissioning from God to make sure you are on track with your life. But not like a, like, go get them, pal, but like a, hey, stop being so dumb, right? You're bad, right? That's the impulse, right? So that's one side of that story. But some people, all they do is read the last half of chapter 4 and the first half of chapter 5 of Ephesians. They live there, right? So they go immediately to the list. Why? Because we like lists. We like clarity. We like, this is what you do, this is what you don't do. You like job descriptions. You like all of, like, that's how we are wired as human beings, by and large, is we like to know where are the boundary lines in this game. The challenge is that many times we approach our spiritual life and all we think about are the boundary lines. So we make our spiritual life about the boundary lines, not about the one who actually created the boundary. So that's legalism, right? That's one way people respond, because there's a whole other way that people respond to lists like Ephesians chapter 5. And that's for them to go back to Ephesians chapter 2. And if you remember Ephesians chapter 2, the culmination of this passage is, by grace you have been saved, not of your works. So not by minding the rules. That's not how you get in the family. Not by works. Right? Lest anyone should boast. Like, no one should take credit for this. But the challenge is, challenges is some people live in chapter 5, but some people get stuck in chapter 2. And they live out their life, and for them, this is how it's phrased, is it doesn't matter really what I do, because my heart's right. My heart's right. I believe this way. I saw a pastor post something on Twitter the other day. He says, I'm a Christian and I cuss a little bit. Right? Which bothers me a little bit. Because what that says to me is this person's over here and they're saying, my heart's right, so it really doesn't matter what I speak with my mouth. My heart's right, so it really doesn't matter how I act with my body. It doesn't matter how I treat other people. It doesn't, because my heart is pointing in the right direction. Like, grace covers me, right? It's by grace that I'm saved, not of works. Not of works. Like, it's not what I do. It's grace. And so what they do is they get this blanket of grace that they hide themselves in, and they live in the darkness that Jesus had saved them from. Right? And it's our tendency to live either over in this camp, that's like rules, 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 or in this camp that says, like, my heart's right. I'm grace, right? Grace. You cannot live in either chapter 2 or either chapter 5. You know where you gotta live? Chapter 2 pushes us toward chapter 5. It's by grace we have been saved, not of works, lest anyone should boast. God saved us out of darkness so that we could live in the light. We could live in the light. So it's not when I'm over here looking at the boundary lines that God's put us in to live our life out. It's not about the boundary lines. It's about Christ. Right? So it's not about keeping the rules and checking the boxes and the thou shalt and the thou shalt not. No. These things, the reason why they matter to God, this list that we're going to look at here in more clarity in a moment, this list that he makes is an effort for us to look like him. Right? So when God says, don't do this, it's because he doesn't do that. And he wants to bring us into light so that we look like him. So there's a mirror image here so that I'm being formed to reflect him. So that I don't live over here and say, grace has got me covered. It doesn't matter how I live. It doesn't matter that I'm a dirty heathen, right? Because God's got me. So I guess I can just hang out here. No. Grace, what God has given me that I didn't deserve, should motivate me. Man, God has changed me. Not only does he give me grace to overcome my sin, but he gives me grace to live out this life toward godliness and holiness. He says, put off the old self. Did you see that? It's like a big coat. I remember when I was growing up, we had this big, I don't even know where we got it. It was this big wool, like trench coat. Somehow, it was like a World War II, like army uniform kind of trench coat they would wear, big wool thing. And somehow, despite the fact that I grew as, into adult-sized person, I somehow still never fit in that coat. Right? This coat was like something out of a movie where it just gets bigger as I go along, right? But I remember being a little kid and taking that out of the closet and putting it and losing myself in that coat, right? That's the image that Paul is trying to paint here. When he says put on, he's literally talking about like robes. He says take off that old self, put on the new self. And the new self, you'll avoid things. You'll choose not to participate. God will grace you, he'll enable you, but you'll also have to put in some effort. He says here's the challenge of living between these two worlds, right? It's not by works, but that doesn't mean you don't put in effort. Like, when we say it's not by works, that means you didn't earn it. You can't earn it. But that does not mean that you don't apply your will, which means putting in some effort. So sometimes you're going to say no instead of yes. God's not going to come down to you in a moment and say, I need you to stop brawling. So I'm going to tie your hands behind your back. That's not how it works, right? You participate with the Spirit of God, and you put in your effort, which is not doing that thing. So let's take a look at the list. You want to take anybody excited about the list? Yeah. Ooh, I'm excited about this list. Dan, go help me out here. Put off falsehood, right? We're supposed to put off. Let's do the next. We're going to do these quick. Put off falsehood. In your anger, do not sin. Ooh, Jesus, help me. Oh, guys. You must steal no longer, okay? Do something useful with your hands, right? Do not let any, I hate it when the Bible, do not unwholesome talk come out of your mouth. Get rid of all, this one, it just gets harder as we go, doesn't it? Bitterness and rage and anger and brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. That person at work, my goodness. Not even a hint of sexual immorality. That word, sexual immorality, is actually one Greek word. It's porneia. It's the word we use for pornography. It means it's like a big category of every kind of sexual immorality there is. A kind of lustful thought to adultery. Everything. Any kind of impurity, greed, obscenity, foolish talk. Man, that's a tough one. Am I right? Like useless Stuff that just doesn't produce anything. Foolish. Coarse joking. Do not be, he really drills down on that one, doesn't he? Do not be foolish. Do not get drunk on wine. Do not get, and I'm not going to do a whole excursus on alcohol today. I'm not going to do that. But I can tell you this with absolute confidence. The Bible does not allow you, forbids you to become inebriated. It's not okay. Amen. Because you lose control of your ability to choose, right? And that's the whole problem, isn't it? Is you lose the ability to employ the will that God gave you. Why do you think that God would get so upset about that? It's because he wants you to be mindful of your choices, right? Look at all these things that are here. How about you? But when I was making the list, when I pulled all the stuff together from these verses of Scripture and made them into a list, there were a few of them that kind of like gave me a punch in the stomach. Anybody? Amen. I mean, they just got me. I mean, I'm sitting there going, man, I do that. I do that. I don't want to do that. Right? Because it's by grace that I've been saved, and grace points me toward godliness and holiness. I don't want to do that. I want to be a child of the light. I want to be a person who walks. I put off the old self. I want to walk in light, not in darkness. I want to put on the new self. I want that to be my life. Because that's the life that God created for me. So how do I do that? How do I live there? I mean, we can read a list like this, and it can do just like it did just this moment and punches you in the gut and makes you go, oh no, I'm on the list. So how do I move from here? I want to give you a couple of things. These are going to be really, really, really practical. In light of a list like this one, like in view of this, and where we read this one, and you read all over the Bible where they say, do this and don't do this. Like, what do you do in response to it when you are out of alignment with God's design for you and his reflection of himself? Like, what do we do? A couple things. The first thing that I want to point you toward is the same thing that you did to come into your relationship with Jesus Christ. The start, and all of us have a different starting point. All of us have a different experience of how we came to faith in Christ. And maybe you're here and you haven't done that yet, and I'm going to give you the starting point right here. I'm going to give it to you. This is how this whole thing starts. I remember growing up, it was framed out in a really simple way. It's the ABC, right? So I'm just using that, right? So admit that I'm a sinner, right? So I saw the list. Okay. I am. I qualify, right? I'm a sinner. Admit that I'm a sinner. But then it's believe, be, right? Believe that Christ died for my sins and came back to life and gives me new life. So it's this powerful belief that Jesus is, by grace you've been saved, right? So it's this pivot away from my sin and toward Christ, where I recognize all the work he has done to satisfy the debt of my sin. And then it's commit. Commit my life to Christ. Make him the Lord of my life. And sometimes we have this false belief that ABC process is for the start of our relationship with Christ. Friends, I got news for you. That's like every day of your relationship with Christ. You never grow past that, because in as much as you are saved, right, at that moment when you give your life to Christ, when you commit yourself to Christ, you have been transported from darkness to light. You are also being saved, right? You're being sanctified. You're being made new in Christ. And so that process never changes. And so today, in a few moments, I'm going to give you a chance. Like, if there was something on that list, it makes you go, oof, that hurts. Holy Spirit's getting on my heart. I admit, God, I do that. I admit that I've sinned. And I believe that the cross and the resurrection are sufficient to conquer that sin in my life. And then I commit my life for God to be the Lord of my life in this area. It never goes away. You live that salvation process over and again. That's the first thing. The second thing is to lean into community. Lean in to community. The impulse with this kind of list is that we don't want to put our name next to any of those publicly, right? Like, you know, we have a person who's like, yep, I steal stuff, right? Josh over here, he's a stealer, right? Like, right? You don't want to do that. You don't. The impulse that we have when we face our own sinfulness, we face our own darkness, what do? We hide, right? What does the enemy want you to do? He wants you to hide, to isolate. But God's big solution, you find it in Ephesians chapter 4, is community. It's don't hide, press into others. Be open and transparent with others, because when you bring that into the light, as Ephesians chapter 5 tells us, it kills the darkness. So when I'm in community, when I get tied up with some people I can trust, I'm not saying you have to blabber all your stuff to everybody. Don't do that. That's unwise. But with the people who are on your team and are going to push you toward Christ, you share those things that said, boy, I lost my temper today. Or I've been struggling with lust, or I have struggled with greed, so all of my time goes toward my job because I want to make more money. Whatever that thing is in your life, you bring it into the light of God's community so that now you get a team, right? Sin has a way of isolating. God's antidote to that is community. The third thing is this: you got to build up guardrails. You got to anticipate your issues. Can I just share with you what I've learned about my spiritual life over the last number of years? Is that my old hang-ups that I really struggled with when I came to faith in Christ have never gone away. Amen. Right? They stay there. Now, they change. They change. So there's a whole lot more of a filter in Josh Willaford today than there was 20 years ago. That's because the Spirit's working in me. But that doesn't change the fact that it's going on up here. Just because it doesn't come out of my mouth doesn't mean I don't harbor all the stuff that creates it. Right? So it's not that I ultimately discard all that. It's just that I get deeper into it. I get to the stuff, so now I can control my tongue a little bit better, but I need to now get into the stuff that drove my anger or my hurtful words. I want to get there because that's really the source, and I'm getting every day a little bit closer to that. And so what I realize over time is that if I know my issues, if I know what my issues are, then I can build guardrails around my life so that I don't go there, right? So Chandler, he's got a little orthodontic work going on in his mouth, which is just the most fun money you'll ever spend. So one of the things that they noticed was like how his bite was coming down. When they start changing his mouth, they need to put in some bumpers. So they put these little gel bumpers in the back of his mouth, right, so he doesn't bite down all the way on his teeth so that they can actually do this. And we need bumpers in our life. So if you have an issue with pornography, then you need to move the computer and you need to get a software like Covenant Eyes or Triple X Church or something like that that can help you make sure that there's guardrails so that you make even create rules in your life that says, hey, God, I want to follow you and I want to love you. I want to put these guardrails up so that I make sure I don't only go on the computer when people are around. Or whatever you got to do. You get the idea. God, I need guardrails in my life so that, because it's not because I'm trying to work my way there or think that it's on me, but it's because you have saved me, you've enabled me to make good and wise choices to make sure I don't go where I need not to be. Some of you, it's guardrails with relationships. I have a friend of mine, who I love dearly. And when we get together, we revert to essentially about the age of 18 or 19. Like it doesn't matter like how responsible we are, what leadership positions we hold, like what our credentials are, any of that stuff, like we get together and we turn into teenagers. Like that happens, right? And you have those people in your life that they're literally your partner in crime, right? They're the person. And we can joke about it because obviously, you know, it can be funny, but there are people in your life who are a negative influence to you. They're like an anchor to you. And maybe one of the guardrails for you is, I need to really limit the amount. Because my ability to exercise willpower, my ability to choose the other option with them, I just don't have it. So make the hard choice. And you say, Josh, that's so hard. Make the hard choice. Make the hard choice. Isn't godliness better? I mean, look at the value of what you're gaining versus what you're losing. Listen, isn't godliness better? Put up the guardrails. Put up the guardrails. And this final one, this is the one that even this morning God was speaking into my heart. I dropped a whole new thing, so some of this is super fresh. Listen to the right voices. Listen to the right voices. And there are three voices that you will be tempted to listen to, or two voices you'll be tempted to listen to. One's a good one. Okay. The voice of guilt, the voice of compromise, or the voice of conviction. The voice of guilt, the voice of compromise, or the voice of conviction. The voice of guilt will come into your life as you face a list down like this one. And what it does is it weighs you down. It makes you look at a list like that one, and all of a sudden now you feel like you've got a weight on your shoulders because you are not good enough. You are blowing this thing. I can't believe you're so bad. Why do you even come to church on a Sunday morning? If people only knew how bad you were, they would stay 100 miles away from you. Am I touching some of the buttons? That's the voice of guilt. Guilt brings nothing but your sin to the table. And it's big. And it's good at pointing out how big it is. The voice of compromise comes in and minimizes. That's what compromise does. If guilt lays it down, compromise minimizes. Compromise will do is it'll pull you to the side and say, it's really not that bad. Like, at the end of the day, like, what you did, I mean, there are people who are doing worse things than you. So, it's really not that bad, what you're doing. Which is dangerous too, right? Because sin is not, like, graded. It, the Bible says over and over and over, sin leads to death. Over and over and over and over and over again. There's no like asterisks next to some that are like, this one's okay, like sometimes in moderation. Like that's never in the Bible. Right? Sin leads to death. Right? So the voice of guilt will heap it down. The voice of compromise will minimize. The voice of conviction that comes from the Holy Spirit pulls you up. When the Holy Spirit comes into your life, the Bible says it this way, the kindness of the Lord leads you to repentance, right? When the Holy Spirit comes into your life and it's conviction of the Holy Spirit, you know, man, this does not align with God's best for me. You know what's going to happen is it's going to say, hey, come this way. Come on. I'm not going to weigh you down, right? It's not what's going to happen. I'm not going to minimize what's happening here. I'm not going to make it small because it's a big deal. But I'm not going to push you down. I'm going to pull you up. That's the voice you need to listen to. The voice of guilt in your life, the voice of guilt will isolate you. You are bad, so you can't hang out over there. You know how many people I've interacted with in my years of pastoral ministry that will come to me and they'll say, I'm going to come to church when I get my life all figured out. When I fix this part of my life, I'll be there on the front row, buddy. And I'm like, what in the world are you doing? In what universe do you think that you're going to fix your life? Like, out there? That's crazy. But that's what guilt does. It isolates. Guilt isolates. Compromise will come in and normalize. Right? It'll compare. So everyone is doing it. They don't know what I went through, right? So you go through a troubling circumstance and you kind of live out some of this list. And they don't know what I went through. And so they'll normalize it. It makes sense, right? They would have done the same that I had done had they faced the pressures that I had faced. But conviction, it doesn't isolate you and it doesn't point toward other people. What it does is it pulls you into community. It pulls you into people who care about you, on your team, who cheer you on, and also kick your tail from time to time. Isn't that a good thing to have in your life? If you don't know this already, I'm going to give you a little fun part here. You need somebody in your life who'll come in and be like, hey, stop it. You do. I've got those people in my life that go, Josh, your attitude right now is not right. The way you're thinking about this situation is not godly. I love those people. I love those people who look at me and be honest with me, not in a judgmental, like, you know, church lady kind of way. Okay? That's what I'm talking about. But in the godly, like, I'm on your team, I want you to succeed, and Josh, this right here, this is going to take you down, and I love you so much, I'm not going to let you stay there. I'm not going to let you stay there. Final thing that this group of voices will do, conviction pushes you, guilt makes you look at yourself. Guilt puts all the conversation on you. It's the consummate navel gazing. It's all about you, all about your bad, and you're constantly down here, right? So it's all about you. Whereas compromise rationalizes, makes you evaluate every problem. In action, it says that it's not that bad. Then conviction, this is the cool part. You know it's the right voice when it doesn't push you down here, it doesn't cause you to stay up here, but when it causes you to turn here. That's what conviction does. It doesn't put my eyes here on me or on others. It puts my eyes on Jesus. You want to get out of this cycle that you've lived in? Well, do the same stuff. Same stuff you've done from the beginning of your relationship with Jesus Christ. Lean into community. Build up the guardrails and listen to the right voices. And you will find, not overnight, but over time, that you will make progress as you continually choose. I'm going to put on my new self. I'm going to put on my new self. God, help me put on my new self. God, I'm going to put on my new self. So that you can be a child of the light and not walk in darkness. Let's pray together. God, our desire, our longing is to be children of the light. That's what we want in our lives. God, we want to live in the salvation that you provide for us. We don't want to live in our brokenness. We don't want to live in our shame. We don't want to live in our darkness. But what we want to do is we want to live in the light. We want to take and put off that old self and put a new self on. Wrap your goodness and righteousness and your character around us so that we can be new. And we can live in the light. God, every one of us has places where we need growth. It doesn't matter how long we've followed you or how many times we've been in church. It doesn't matter. Any of those qualifiers don't matter. All of us have stuff in our life that doesn't reflect back to you your character and your goodness. And God, I would pray for the voice of your Holy Spirit to bring conviction. Not the voice of the enemy who's right now, even as we speak, trying to heap that guilt or bring that compromise. The voice of the Holy Spirit who brings conviction, which doesn't weigh us down. He pulls us up toward Jesus. Doesn't minimize, doesn't rationalize, but he does. So he pulls us up to Jesus so that we can have victory over our sin, because it's the kindness of the Lord that leads us to repentance. So Father, would you allow your Spirit to kind of get into our world a little bit, not to harm us, but so that we can be children of the light. I'm going to invite you to keep your heads bowed and your eyes closed this morning. We're going to move into a time of reflection and response. This is just a time for you to talk with Jesus. The Word of God is something we respond to. We don't just let it hit us and then walk away. We absorb it, and we allow the Spirit to lead us. And here's what I want you to do today. Is if there's something there that you seeing that list, or maybe something the Spirit is putting into your heart right now. Say, boy, this right here, this doesn't reflect my character back to me. It needs to change. And I guarantee you the Spirit of God is there to help you and equip you and move your heart toward Christ, because there is no sin in this room, hear this today, that is so big or overwhelming or on your mind so bad that God cannot give you victory over that sin. Hear me today. You might be bound in addiction. You're thinking, there's no way. I am stuck. Listen, there is no addiction that God can't beat. There is no sin that God has not already conquered. There is no stuff in your life that God is stressed out about that he can't fix it, because he can fix anything. You give him your heart, and listen, he can transform your life. So this morning, I'm going to invite you into the very simple thing that we all start our relationship with God with. And maybe you're here today, and you haven't started a relationship with God, so you get to do this for the very first time here this morning, and your life can be transformed by Jesus Christ. But it's to admit that I'm a sinner. It's to admit that I have offended on this list. I've separated myself from God, but that God was so gracious and loving and merciful that Jesus Christ came and he transformed you through him taking your sin, your consequences, and conquering them by coming back to life so that you too can have life also. And you get the chance to give your life completely and totally to him. This is the next few minutes. They're going to give you 2 or 3 minutes to just process this with just music playing, and then we'll sing a song together. But I want you to take these few minutes and just walk this stuff out with Jesus, knowing that God has the ability to transform every area of your life. Take these next few minutes with the Lord.